On today's episode of The Unwritten Rule, Kobe Brown absolutely cooked in the summer league yesterday. So we're going to talk about that to start the show, as well as a bunch of recruiting stuff for football, men's basketball, and some more baseball stuff, including, of course, an update on Ryan Wingo's timeline, the big five-star, with some links to Mizzou. We'll do quick hits, and then we're going to finish the show talking a little Tennessee football with all the sanctions. We're going to break all that down and just kind of what it means and what they're implicated in with one of the powerhouses of the SEC facing some football peril. So a great show coming up for all you guys. The Unwritten Rule starts right now.
Attention. Everybody stop what you're doing. It's time for The Unwritten Rule, a Mizzou sports podcast brought to you by the Believe Network, alongside Peyton Haverman and Kenny Van Doren. Here is your host, Jack Knowlton.
Welcome back to The Unwritten Rule. Today is Monday, July 17th. And Kenny and Peyton, Kobe Brown is named after Kobe Bryant. Did you guys know that? Because apparently no one knew that ever before until before his performance on Friday night for the Los Angeles Clippers. He confirmed that in a little post-game interview with the broadcasters that set a little bit of NBA Twitter afire. Everybody who was a Mizzou sports fan just told them a thing they already knew. But, yeah, Kobe Brown, named after Kobe Bryant. Glad we cleared that up. 35 points. Kenny Payton, fact check me on these stats. I went off my memory. I think I have these all right. 35 points, 8 rebounds, 4 steals, 3 assists, 2 blocks, and I believe shooting 7 of 10 from 3-point range. He was absolutely everywhere in the Clippers' win over the Philadelphia 76ers. A win also that, crazy enough, they, because of the way the summer league works, they needed to win by at least 13. They were down by 21 at one point and pulled it all the way back to win the game by 11, mostly thanks to Kobe's contributions. It was pretty wild stuff. Was definitely, you know, I know my Twitter timeline, I was firing off tweets left and right, just spamming Kobe Brown stuff. But yeah, Kenny Payton, what a performance. Certainly proving why he deserved that first round nod to the Los Angeles Clippers.
Yeah, it took him a couple games. He had a couple weaker games from beyond the arc, but my gosh, he made up for it in a big way. I mean, that was his point total there, 35, is higher than his college high. It took him only a few games to do that, and yes, it is just the summer league still, but I mean, these are still guys that are going out there to compete. Some guys, I mean, take the summer league as like basically a lifeline to try and get in the NBA, just break through there. So hopefully, I mean, we can look back and say this was like legitimate competition that he did it with. Obviously, he's not going to go in the regular season. He's not going to go off for 35 points unless something truly heinous has happened to the Clippers roster. But gosh, if he can just be like someone you can bring off the bench, just be able to get you a couple points, grab a few boards. I mean, that's valuable for a late, quite literally the last first round pick.
You really saw that humble side of Kobe after the game too. The Clippers got the cameras in their face from the social media team. And they're like, because he didn't even know how many points he scored. And they said, oh, he had 33, 35. He was like, oh, that's more than I had at Mizzou. And he's just big smile on his face. You know, that's a Kobe we know, the Kobe we've seen. And he can get on the floor and he can get your face. You can pump the muscles at you. We saw him do that in that block 2 games ago. And another game tonight. It's just really cool to see from Kobe. One of the big things, I think we mentioned this before, is that Paul George was at one of these games and was watching Kobe play. And he was like, you know, he's doing the little things. I mean, he's getting in there. He gets dirty, but, you know, he can play really well. And it's really good praise to hear from a guy like Paul George, who has been a multi-time All-Star and one of the best players on the Clippers.
Yeah, we had like he's getting good at the stare down. Kobe mm-hmm. is and the little, you're right, like the kind of the flex, just not all the way, you know, with the traditional one, but he just kind of he's good at the stare down, I guess. And yeah, Peyton, you mentioned the post game interview. It was pretty funny. I mean, you know, obviously they confirmed for themselves that he was named after Kobe Bryant. I don't know how you don't just research that. It's not that hard to find. But yeah, he was super tired, like Kenny said, really humble. you know, after the game. They asked him about, I don't know if y'all watched or heard the commentators talk about this. They told a story that I didn't know about. This is that he was trying to improve like his diet when he was at Mizzou, but he bought like a smoker and another thing. And they were talking about like what he would cook. And they asked him about that. Very, very random stuff. They were like, I think they were just like, did you ever cook any vegetables on the smoker? And he was like, no, they were only used for like, you know, garnish or whatever, which I thought was kind of funny. But yeah, very cool for him to get the spotlight. He had a block or a steal off of an inbound pass when it was like 98-90 Clippers. And that, you know, he punched it on the other side on a 1-on-0 to make it 100-98 and seal their win. And yeah, I mean, breaking down the performance a little bit more, like Peyton said, you know, he's not going to be able to take 19 shots from the field in a regular NBA game. He won't be on the court long enough to even come close to doing that. But the defensive impact, I think, for me is what has carried over from all of his games, even the ones when he wasn't scoring as much. He's been great on the glass, averaged, I think, 8.8 rebounds. I'm looking at a tweet. Hoops Hype ranked their best players of the NBA Summer League, put Kobe fourth in that list. So, you know, he's making noise. And I mean, this is a first round pick. We know his contract's guaranteed, but like you said, Peyton, if he can get someone like Paul or Kenny, I think said this, the Paul George thing, like if he can get some of the support from those better players, like he's going to be a guy that is proving to be very useful, no matter how limited his minutes are. You know, it's just really, really cool to see. And yeah, 35 points. Unbelievable. He broke his Mizzou total in the NBA already. I mean, that's just really impressive. I don't know if y'all have any other thoughts on it, but
I mean,
it was so fun.
Kenny did say it best. Like, I did see, because Kobe reposted it to his Instagram story. Just as
repost everything.
Yeah.
Repost everything. His Instagram story.
He's gotten,
I think
better
he's a bot.
He's gotten,
I think
better.
He's a bot that does it. So
he's gotten better. I did notice he didn't repost a couple people. But the second the camera was in Kobe's face, you saw him look over and then get like that shy grin. Like, Kobe was very, very humble when he was at Mizzou. And it's just good to see that he's still kind of got the whole just shy but nice nature. I mean, everyone seems to love him when they talk to him. He's a great interview. And yeah, we know what he's capable of. I mean, we saw it here for 4 years. I'm happy for him. Hopefully it continues. Hopefully he carves out a nice role with the Clippers.
I have one joke comment to make before we move on from Kobe. I know that a lot of the football or the basketball players lived at Brookside townhomes where Peyton used to live. It's a good area to have a smoker back there. I mean, those nice little backyards. Peyton had one. Peyton actually, like, his room backed up to the backyard, and so we could have a smoker. So Peyton could have been out there with Kobe.
Little barbecue, yeah.
A little barbecue with him, but he decided not to. He decided to move into the city and live in a high rise.
There you go. Peyton on the move. The only other thing is, of course, Kobe, he'll get a chance to kind of build off that performance Sunday when we're recording this. Sunday night, Kobe's going to face off against his teammate, Damoy Hodge from Mizzou, Clippers-Lakers at 9 p.m. So I'll definitely be tuning in to see who kind of comes out on top there. Damoy certainly has been impressive in the summer league as well, especially for an undrafted guy. A lot more to play for him, contract situation wise than Kobe Brown. So yeah, plenty to look forward to for those two. And yeah, Kobe again, 35 points, breaking his Mizzou career high for the Clippers. Very, very exciting stuff. I'll stick in the basketball realm first. We have recruiting for men's basketball. Dennis Gates is still on the move. Just a quick, I guess, little update. Bishop Boswell, who is on Three's 50th ranked recruit, put Mizzou in his top six, along with Georgia, Xavier, Wake Forest, Tennessee, and South Carolina. So some decent hitters, along with Mizzou, obviously Tennessee being probably the most notable in terms of their recent men's basketball performances. But guys, any thoughts on Boswell and Gates? We've seen an interesting kind of 2024 recruiting trail for him so far with the Dallas Thomas stuff. And he, of course, has a couple guys already.
I mean, I would say it is kind of funny that this dropped quite literally like in the waning seconds of Kobe's performance in the summer league. Because that's something Dennis Gates can point to. He can point to DeMoy Hodge. He can point to Kobe Brown and really hang his hat on that as a recruiting tool. I mean, he could just literally get Bishop Boswell into a room and just show him mock drafts from before the season that didn't have Kobe going anywhere, and then Kobe dropping 35 in the summer league. And obviously, a lot of that is going to be just Kobe making his own improvements, just making himself a better player, but it can take a little credit for that if you're Dennis Gates. And also, just reading through the list, I would think Mizzou's in decent shape here, simply because he's already taken an official visit there. He's taken an official visit to Xavier, I believe an unofficial to Georgia. I will say, I would think right now Mizzou's two biggest competitors here would be Tennessee and Xavier, simply because he's visited Xavier already. He just picked up an offer from Tennessee, and they still were able to crack his top six. So that would indicate there's some interest from him there. But I would think Mizzou probably feels good about where they're at. Maybe they'll have him on campus again, but definitely good to see that a lot of 2024 recruits are certainly interested in Mizzou.
Looking at is a four-star right now in the class of 2024, and I'm looking at the prediction machine on On3, because On3 was the one who reported this, Joe Tipton, of course, who's their lead basketball reporter. He's a four-star on all outlets, you know, Rivals.com, ESPN, 247 as well. Their prediction machine right now has Mizzou at 33.3%. That's right behind Xavier, which is leading the charge at 38.1%. Kind of reading through this article as well from Joe Tipton. Joe Tipton always likes to get like a few quotes or, you know, a few words on each team and just what's really stood out. The first one was Missouri, and he said, "What the coaches see in me and for me at Mizzou and the time head coach Gates has already invested in me in a short time." I mean, the quote doesn't really make all that much sense. I don't know. It sounded like there wasn't a verb in there, but it sounds like there's a lot of investment there from Coach Gates. I will point out his shortest quote was about Mizzou. His longest quote was about Tennessee.
Interesting.
You have to read through that, though. The Tennessee one is because he had to throw in an extra sentence about Tennessee just offering him the week before.
There was no extra sentence. It was one run-on sentence.
Oh, well.
It was a really long sentence.
An extra bit about.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. He does like the history of the program at Tennessee is what he also said.
Yeah. The Tennessee program that is basically comparable to Mizzou in men's basketball.
Yeah. So comparing sentences aside, it seems like it's very prototypical Gates here on the recruiting trail for yet another four-star prospect. So we'll keep monitoring, obviously, Boswell's situation with that top six and see if Mizzou continues to be a contender for him there. Staying on the recruiting trail, we have Ryan Wingo news. Exciting stuff for Mizzou football. We learned over the weekend that he will announce his commitment on December 20th. That is, of course, the first day of the early signing period for 2024 recruits. Kenny and Peyton, Mizzou seems to have a better chance with him over Williams-Wanneri. I think we've talked about that extensively enough. But, you know, with this kind of break, we know now the timeline for recruiting Wingo up until when he's going to decide. You know, what does that mean for Mizzou? And have there been maybe any updates on where they stand with Wingo?
I mean, Wingo being December 1st or December 20th, was it? I forget the exact date. In December, long ways off.
December 20th, I believe.
Yeah. Very, very, very good news for Mizzou, I would say, because Mizzou has a chance to really, if they win 8 games, I'd say, I think that shows Wingo, hey, we've got a lot of positive momentum here. They can pitch that to him. That's probably the one thing that really bogs down the Mizzou in the running for Wingo, is that right now, Wingo can't even be sure Drinkwitz will be around next year. I do remember him saying that the coaching staff has a great relationship with his family. That's always a plus. But he did also say he has to do what's best for him. And Mizzou's going to have an opportunity now to kind of show, hey, this is a program you can come and start to win. You can be a big part of it. It definitely is better than Wanneri, and Wanneri is committing August 1st, I believe I saw, and that is probably not going to go Mizzou's way. But Wingo, I think that's very good news for them. They've been getting a lot of good news about Wingo recently, so hopefully they can start winning some games in the regular season and carry that over to his recruitment.
My initial thoughts are that, you know, when you announce your commitment right during, you know, the first day of the early signing period, there's no chance of flipping you. I mean, it's very hard to flip a five-star to begin with, especially when they announce their commitment so late. And if Ryan Wingo does land at Texas, of course, that is where Director of Football Recruiting for 24/7 Steve Wilfong has crystal balled him right now. You know, I think whoever he commits on that first day is who he's signing with. I mean, I didn't see it on the tweet or any of the reports if he's going to actually sign that day. That's usually what happens, though, when you see guys like this announce their commitment. They're just going to hit that. I think it's the NLI. It's not NIL, mm-hmm. but NLI is your national letter of intent. And I think that's he might sign it right then and there.
Yeah, a lot of acronyms in college football. A lot to keep track of. But yes, I think that's a good point, Kenny, is that it seems like, you know, with this decision, it's this is where I'm going and I'm fully locked in. There's not going to be a I forget who is the Oregon guy again that Oregon got to flip from Mizzou?
Theone Gray.
That's Theone Gray. So there won't be a situation like that if he does choose Mizzou. It would seem at least. So yeah, Ryan Wingo, December 20th, we're going to learn where he'll go. So Mizzou has obviously that season to like Peyton said, maybe go 8-4 or something like that. And you know, Drinkwitz is safe. A lot of details still to be worked out there. On the other recruiting thing, I've got, gentlemen, Mizzou baseball, Kerrick Jackson landing another recruit. We had the two guys last week in Curtis and Corona, which I was watching some videos of Jarrett Curtis. Little side note, I'm excited to see him play. He looks pretty decent. This is just that like a little showcase of him. They said like he broke some sprint record. I don't remember exactly he's apparently really fast. Peyton said it and I was following up. So first and foremost, I'm excited about Curtis, but can you guys break down landing another recruit, Kerrick Jackson, for Mizzou baseball in 2024?
Yeah. I mean, he's starting to finally fill out his roster for next year. He's tweeted like 20 bat signals in the last week. A lot of those are going to be 2024 commits that we don't really hear about for a bit. But, I mean, Jedier Hernandez, I mean, they needed a catcher. Fargo departed for Tennessee. Trey Morris was out of eligibility, I believe. And I believe Dylan Leach is still in the portal. I don't remember if he signed anywhere yet. But they needed a catcher. Hernandez, decent hitting numbers, I would think. I wouldn't think it would translate very well to the SEC, so maybe he's more of a defensive backstop. I'm not so sure. But you got to start getting bodies at the position. Certainly doesn't hurt to get a guy this early because it likely means you have a lot of faith in him.
He's played a lot of summer ball. He's played in three different summer ball leagues. The Trenton Generals, played for Burlington and Wareham. Just looking at the numbers initially, though, he's a contact guy. He's just putting the ball in play. There's not a lot of slugging behind him. One thing that really stood out to me is those 24 walks to 15 strikeouts. Good approach there in your sophomore season. Of course, we don't know if that's going to translate to SEC competition. There are some good pitchers in the Big East. Of course, the Big East pitcher of the year went in the third round this year to the Astros. But Yadier Hernandez, my favorite part of this whole situation, I was looking through his Twitter. I don't know if this is actually Yadi's chest protector, but he has a Yadier Molina chest protector that says Yadi and has the number 4 on it. Of course, it's the old Rawlings that Yadier Molina used to wear. I think Yadi moved to Nike through his last couple seasons. So I think maybe Yadier donated one to him or maybe bought it somewhere, but it looks pretty cool on him.
Let's sure hope he's more like early career Yadi.
There's
our shot at the Cardinals for the episode.
Yeah, there's the Cardinals shot. Show. I was gonna say too that might make a lot of Mizzou fans happy because there's of course a lot of Cardinals fans that'll probably be rooting for him now. Him coming in, but yeah. Another recruit, Yadier Hernandez, committing to Mizzou baseball. Kerrick has been active as we've seen with the two transfers last that we talked about last show. So it was seeming. Have Mizzou baseball news always down the pipeline. Okay. Good recruiting.
McLennan from CBC in St. Louis, class 2024 wide receiver, tweeted today. So we're not going to have it for you on this show, but he said his top five is coming out 4 PM Sunday. Of course, Ohio State looks like the favorite, according to 247, Oregon right behind them. Mizzou was in his top 12. I don't always understand tweeting a top 12 graphic, but get your social media presence out there. And I'm sure Mizzou might fall into that top five just because it's an in-state school.
They'll probably be the only team he hasn't visited in this top five just because they're there down the road. They'll be a throw in. They're not going to get McClellan.
Yeah.
So Payne's confirming it already, but
they're totally not getting him.
I was actually looking at his Twitter because I remember when he was visiting, like during the season, and I think I DM'd him once. I'm looking at it. I sent him like a pretty, like, you know, maybe two or three sentences, and I said, "Do you know when you'll be visiting Mizzou?" And he just said, "Tomorrow." That's it. Just nothing else. I sent him like two or three sentences, but yeah,
it was unofficial, right?
December 10th, it looks like. Yeah, I think it was just like a game visit, so it wasn't. I have no idea if it was.
He hasn't taken an official, if I'm not mistaken.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah,
unlucky Mizzou's chances.
Looking unlikely there, but we'll have that hit, I'm sure, if Mizzou is still in that. I love top 30 graphics. Those are my favorite. It's just a
barrage of
logos.
Offer lists.
Offer lists.
Offer lists.
Just loaded.
Ungodly. Yeah.
Just like, find your logo.
He put FIU right next to
Alabama.
Alabama. Yeah.
He's definitely thinking about those two schools with the same amount of
Georgia is next to UTSA.
Go Roadrunners. 2-1-0. All right. Yeah. Good Mizzou news segment. We will have a McClellan, of course, next show that hit, even though Peyton's already ruling it out, which fair enough. But and yeah, with that, we will segue over to quick hits. All right. Quick hits time. Kenny, get us started. Jerseys of the weekend.
Jersey of the weekend. We're going to dip our feet back into the Mizzou football world and go with Cody Schrader. Switched his number to number 7. Of course, that was Dominic Lovett's number last season. Big move there for Cody Schrader, who was in Division II football not too long ago.
Yeah, he has a cool lion tattoo. I interviewed him about it once.
We also saw him at a bar after the bowl game last year.
I have heard about that story.
Nice guy.
Anyways, Peyton.
Speaking with Mizzou, my jersey of the week, DeAndre Gholston. OSE Lions, or just the Mizzou one, since probably no way out. But
we can make a Photoshop. You're better than Bleacher Report.
Gholston was the third Tiger from last year to go pro. Obviously, Des Moines and Kobe are kicking in the summer league. DeAndre will be going overseas. He'll have an opportunity with the OSE Lions of the Hungarian league. So, good luck to him. Hopefully, he kills it over there. There's a chance. I mean, I don't know anything about the Hungarian league. His play style may be perfect over there. He might put up numbers.
Peyton, you had a really funny tweet about it where you said you tweeted the video of the Tennessee buzzer beater and you said DeAndre Gholston to the Etero Mu Packs in his third game. Mm-hmm. It was just the Tennessee buzzer beater. So yeah, green light Gholston.
Rain him, man. He's so good at those.
He might be like so good against like some of that competition. Might be like translatable to some like a college league, you know, maybe in the US, that they might like treat him like a god. Like he's just like so good. Like there's like he's like the LeBron of their team. I feel like I could see that happening.
It could. Funny. Yeah, you never know.
He literally had a spelling bee of Hungarian cities like 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Yeah, great time. Go check out that reel or TikTok. He's been tweeting too about he said he's had a fire lit under him after not being picked up or going to any combine or anything for the league. So now you got your chance. See how he does. My jersey of the week, LeBron James, number 23. You might be asking yourself, he already wore 23. No, he didn't. He switched to 6 and now he's switching back because they are. So the NBA retired number 6 for Bill Russell last season. They let LeBron wear it for a year and now he's switching back to 23. Very exciting stuff. Another way to grit the Lakers in the headlines for the offseason. My more beef with this is everyone go on Bleacher Report's Twitter because Bleacher Report decided to Photoshop LeBron back into 23, even though he already wore it and they could have just used a real photo. And the Photoshop is awful. Absolutely awful. Peyton has no issue with it for some reason, but it looks terrible.
But no, this is a classy move from Le 23. Trace. That's it. Welcome back to Patriots.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, what is 23 is a great number.
I heard Anthony Davis is switching his to just the Disney logo. So he's not going to wear 23 anymore. He's going to have a Disney logo.
Hey, Disney.
It's actually just the it's actually just the symbol of the hospital because he's always injured. That's his new number.
Come on, man.
Class.
I need to take a shot. Yeah, classless. That was a classless joke. What?
He's always hurt.
He can't control his health. That's not his fault.
All right. Yeah, you're right. He wasn't injured last year. It's fine. He's going to
spelling
the
bee. We're going to the spelling bee this week. I got this idea from Peyton because he had a beat on the WNBA All-Star game for Friday. So the spelling bee this week is going to be players from Team Stewart and Team Wilson. I'll let you guys choose who wants to start.
Peyton. Jack Knowlton.
Peyton.
Jack's going first.
Peyton's going first.
Jack's going first. Dewana Bonner.
I guess we don't choose. Dewana?
Dewana Bonner.
Okay.
Good luck.
D.
Mm-hmm.
W.
Nope. Okay.
Oh, that's not good. That's how I would have gone. D A W.
Nope. We didn't even get two letters into this one. Dewana Bonner's name is spelled D E W A N N A B O N N E R.
Oh, I guess Dewana. That makes Bonner. Yeah. That makes sense.
Mm-hmm. You would have gotten Bonner. Is that what you just said?
Yeah, that's an easy one.
All right, Cheyenne Parker.
Oh, it's easy. Come on, you got this.
Yeah. You're going, Peyton.
That's not how this works, but okay.
No, it is. Yeah, I went first last time. You're going first.
C-H-E-Y-E-N-N-E. What was her last name?
Parker.
P-A-R-K-E-R.
There you go. For the third
she
name.
Taking that one, Knowlton.
Starting center for Team Wilson, Elijah Boston.
What?
Elijah
Boston.
What
did you just say, Kenny?
Team Wilson.
Do you mean Aaliyah Boston?
Yeah, you mean Aaliyah Boston.
Oh, Aaliyah Boston. What did I say? Did I say Elijah?
Elijah. It's Aaliyah.
Oh, I didn't say Elijah. I didn't say Elijah.
Yeah, you did.
Yes, no, you
I
didn't. Did.
Play the recording yes, back. Did. I did not say
it's
Elijah
quite
Boston.
Literally burned.
Play the recording. Say less.
Dude, it's burned onto a recording that's going to be put on a server that outlasts humanity. So you said Elijah.
Eliah Boston
for all of attorney. It's Aaliyah Boston, I believe, and I don't even it doesn't even have a J in it. I don't think
I said a J.
So I don't know where you got it Elijah from.
I didn't say a J.
You said Elijah.
Okay,
I definitely said Elijah.
Spell her name. Y'all don't know to spell it. That's why you're.
No,
I still know how to spell it. I covered a game with her last year.
A L. I. Y-A-H?
Yeah.
B-O-S-T-O-N? Okay, nice. I was hoping. I've also covered Aaliyah Boston, so I was hoping I spelled the name right. Nice.
All right. Last name. Peyton's going to go here. Kaylee Copper.
K-A.
There's a trick in here.
Yeah, it's right here. It's either Y. I'm going to say it is Y.
Nope. Jack. Kaylee Copper.
K-A-L? Okay.
Whoa.
K-A-E?
Nope.
What on earth?
K-A-H-L-E-A-H.
Oh,
Kaylee.
And then copper, C-O-P-P-E.
It's too many forms of Kaylee. Too many ways to spell that.
All right.
Crapshoot.
Best beats of the week. Jack and I are going to stick in the tennis world after missing horribly on Wimbledon. We're going to the Swedish Open, and I got Sebastian Baez. Winning his first round. The money line is -261. I'm not going with the underdog here. And Federico Coria, Sebastian Baez, lock.
Yeah, you guys picked against the favorite. I said that was dumb, and I was right about that. But then I picked a favorite, and they lost. So I'm going to go with an underdog this week. We're going over to the Nippon Leagues. We're going to take the Tohoku Rakuten Golden Eagles. They're +122 over the Chiba Lot Marines. I don't know who's on either of these teams. Hopefully Munetaka Murakami is on one of them because he's my favorite player. But
he's your favorite player, but you don't know who he plays for.
Don't know who he plays for, but his show, his card in Diamond Dynasty in the show is crazy cool. So
fair enough. Yeah, I'm still wearing the Wimbledon hat because the men's finals going on right now. I'm leaning to check the score because they're in the fifth set right now as we're recording this with Alcaraz and Djokovic, who, Kenny, we are dumb for not just betting on those two. We both picked the underdogs, and yeah, it was not even close in either of the semifinals. So we'll see. I think Alcaraz is winning the fifth set right now. So he might be about to dethrone Novak. But I am still also going to bet on tennis, also in the Swedish Open. I'm picking Alexander Shevchenko, plus 101 versus Juan Manuel Serrandolo. Give me Shevchenko to pull off the little bit of an upset. I almost picked a bet where the guy was like plus 750 or something to win.
A lot of money.
It would have been a high risk, high reward, I guess. But yeah, our betting has not been good in the last couple shows.
Yeah, I'm 1-1, and I think you guys are 0-2. So
we went 0 for last week's or last show. Mm-hmm. So there you go.
Hopefully people are not taking our advice.
Yeah. Dirty Birds.
I think do you guys both live in a state that you can't bet in?
I'm not allowed to bet legally in my
Legally bet in my state either. Okay. Dirty Birds of the weekend. Jimmy Butler is reportedly dating Shakira. Shakira, Shakira. Here's a quote from US Weekly. Jimmy makes Shakira smile. And Shakira is happy spending time with him. They follow each other on Instagram as well. Bunch of headlines out there. Of course, Jimmy Butler played for the Golden Eagles of Marquette, and that's how he is a dirty bird. I mean, he could be a main bird. He found love. That's all that matters. Mm-hmm.
That is good for him. I'm glad they're happy together. My dirty birds of the week are going to be Team Wilson and her WNBA All-Star game, team. They were the heavy favorites. They were my best beat of the weekend, and they lost. They lost to Team Breonna Stewart. You may be wondering, why are they dirty birds? Because Asia Williamson and her starting center, who was in the spelling bee, Aaliyah Boston, they both went to South Carolina. They were both Gamecocks, and they're dirty birds. They cost me a free game.
Sir Big Spur.
Yep.
Did you say Asia Williamson?
I said Elijah.
No, I didn't.
No, you said Elijah. What a mispronounce it out the wazoo.
I meant to say Asia Wilson, if I did say that.
Yeah, that was unfortunate, Peyton. You texted, we have a group chat for our show. Just you were very outraged at that, and now we went 0 for you. You couldn't have even rubbed it in on us for being the only one to get his bet this last show. Mm-hmm. But yeah, tough. My dirty bird of the weekend. I am going with Steph Curry. I wanted to talk about this in some form because Sabrina Ionescu beat Steph Curry's record in the three-point contest. She got 37, only missed two threes the entire time. Steph Curry gave her some praise on Twitter for that. It was obviously a crazy performance. Sabrina Ionescu was an Oregon Duck, so Steph Curry beaten by a duck, dirty bird, de facto. And maybe will this mean he'll try and enter the three-point contest next year to get his title back? But yeah, shout out to Sabrina. That's pretty crazy to only miss two threes. It would have been a better fit for the main bird, but you know, I got to spin zone it how I wanted. But yeah, it's pretty wild.
Steph Curry also had a crazy weekend himself. I mean, he hit a hole.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, he hit the hole in one
in the American Century Championship. Someone handed him a basketball, and of course, he threw it backwards over his head and almost made it first try. There were some funny tweets about that, but yeah.
Yeah. So shout out Sabrina Ionescu. 37. I think 37 points.
They should do one where they combine it, like the best shooters from the WNBA and the best from the NBA. And they should go on a battle. Like they could do like a team too. Like one person from the WNBA teams up with someone from the NBA, and then they put their points together. I think that would be fun.
Yeah.
Also, that noise I made was a duck because she was an Oregon duck.
Thanks, Kenny.
I think we got, but
cool. What'd you learn, Peyton?
Best thing I learned this week, Kansas football, who Mizzou was notably not, they were afraid to play in the Liberty Bowl. Mizzou was petrified of 6-6 Kansas. Kansas football lost a recruit this weekend because, not to another team, because of baseball. Multi-sport star Noah Barber of Blue Valley North, he was a 6'3", 180-pound DB who was committed to KU football. He signed with the Kansas City Royals. He signed a free agent deal. So I don't even know if he was drafted. I didn't check that.
Wow.
The way that tweet makes it sound, he was just undrafted and decided, I'd rather go play for the Royals organization than Kansas football. That's the best thing I learned.
Is what position does he play in baseball?
I don't know.
We don't know.
Did you do any research on this guy?
I saw that he was committed to Kansas and then is not at Kansas anymore.
I was just gonna say if he's a pitcher, does Barber have a cutter? Like him?
Oh man. Kenny, what's
I'm interested Kenny, in learn? This. I'm looking more.
Look
into
up if he's
right
a pitcher.
So he was a pitcher, an outfielder, and a shortstop.
He was a pitcher.
In high school.
Okay.
He was a preferred walk on, so he wasn't even.
I didn't even see that. But hey, that makes sense recruit.
Then. I mean, this was a Google search away. Let's see, I'm trying to find him.
I didn't look it up. I
just for not doing his research.
I did. I researched everything else. I didn't research that. I was just like,
it is pretty crazy though that a high schooler. I'd never seen this before that a high schooler who went undrafted signed a free agent deal after the draft. So I'm interested to know what the details are on that contract.
This is wowing Kenny's world.
Kenny's also
I've seen this. A
draft hawk. I mean, he loves the MLB draft. He loves minor league systems. Just go peruse his Twitter.
Transaction pages.
Mm-hmm. Oh, he was going to be a corner. He was going to be a corner at Kansas.
Oh. Yeah, I can understand not wanting to get burned by Big 12 receivers and just choosing to go play baseball.
Kansas football actually tweeted a photo of him in his full uniform and him throwing a baseball up in the air on the Hoffman scoreboard. Everyone in the comments. Why does this seem so passive aggressive? Good luck to our guy, Noah Barber, who has signed in as an undrafted free agent with the Royals. I don't know what was passive aggressive about that, but congrats to Kansas.
Seems a little cringe.
All right. Best thing I learned. Jack can actually talk about this a little bit more, but there's a new segment for Mizzou Hoops. Of course, we had the Sternberg Scoop last season. This season, we have Noah's Ark, first trip on the Ark, Nick Honor, and freshman guard Anthony Robinson. Anthony Robinson looks so young compared to those two guys. And another thing that I really pointed out about Noah Carter is I think he has a new tattoo. He has a tattoo of his name on his arm right here.
Wait, I didn't notice that. It just says Noah Carter on his arm.
Yeah, it says Noah Carter. I think he also has a cross. So,
Is it in cursive or is it like Comic Sans?
No, it's block letters.
Oh wow, so, that's a choice.
Might have heard.
I would do it in the like worst, most generic like English school font that you could find. Just Comic Sans or like Arial, Times New Roman.
That's the new segment there, and I think Jack's mentioned it a couple times.
Yeah, this is my I wrote about the Mizzou men's basketball team last season, and I had learned about Noah's Ark very early on, and I never like followed up on it with a story. So I would have been able to call this content stolen if I had, but alas, I couldn't. I really wanted to take a ride on the boat and just do like an interview with Noah, friend of the show, has been on here, but. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's still cool though. I'm glad they're doing something with the boat. And if any Missourian writers listening to this, there's a little story idea for you. Go write about the boat.
I will
carry on my legacy.
I will also say it was a good segment. I enjoyed it. Especially Nick Honor is just funny.
he is funny. Jeez.
But I wanted to see if they caught a fish. I don't think they caught a fish. They didn't show them catching.
they definitely would have showed one if they caught one. Yeah. Where is that pond that they were in?
I have no idea where it is. But
Stevens Lake Park.
But I don't know. Noah's a big
can't get a boat
fisher,
in there.
A big fisher of men. Because I mean, if you remember just a few weeks ago, I mean, him and Dennis were out fishing. Dennis was probably dropping the dad wisdom.
Oh yeah.
You know what they say, Noah. You know. Feed a man a fish, give a man a fish, you'll feed him for a day. Teach a man to fish, you'll feed him for a lifetime.
The only reason he's saying that is because someone tweeted at him today.
Zach Hernandez, friend of the show.
Teach a man to fish, he'll tattoo his own name on his arm. I think that'll be a future antlers sign, I feel like, at the Mizzou student section is like fish caught, and they'll just have like a ticker. And they'll keep updating it as more segments come out. Do you think, like, what are they going to do in December for the segment? Like ice fishing? There's not.
That would be really sick. That would be really sick if they.
It would be sick. It would be sick.
I don't think the ice is thick enough to ice fish in Missouri.
It makes it easier to get to the water.
Nolton,
especially if your body fall through it.
Yeah, yeah. You're already with the fish then, and you can just scoop them up.
Nolton, you will go into shock within seconds and drown.
What if they do noodling? You know, do you guys know what noodling is? That's how you catch catfish, and it's where you stick your arm in the catfish's hole, like burrow that it lives in, and it bites your arm, and you pull it up. That's how you catch it.
Oh wow, I have seen that before.
Yeah, it's pretty wild. I would like that. That terrifies me.
Rather, with just a fishing pole. But...
That's years of growing up watching a River Monsters on a like Animal Planet. That show was
deadliest
great.
Catch.
Yeah, Deadliest Catch.
Those
shows rock.
Deadliest Catch has zero fish being caught. It is crab.
It's crabs. My best thing I learned this week, Philip Rivers. He's back in the headlines because he's having another child, his 10th. That means with Philip Rivers as the quarterback, they can now make a full NFL offense. ESPN, in fact, made a graphic when they announced this of all of his kids lined up in positions. And they said that Philip Rivers' wife was the coach and GM. I just think this is kind of funny. And, you know, how many wins could they get against the Tom Brady-led Patriots?
I've made this joke before, but they need to have Philip Rivers' family go against Antonio Cromartie's family because that would be a showdown for the ages. If you don't know, Antonio Cromartie also has a large family.
What about the Foremans? They could face the Foremans.
Isn't it all of George Foreman's kids are like George?
That's what I was going to say. I'm disappointed Philip Rivers didn't name all of his kids like just Philip Rivers. Because that's what George Foreman did. There's like George the Ninth or whatever.
Philippines Rivers. I mean, like, he could go anywhere with Philip.
Philippines Rivers.
Philippines Rivers. Yeah, I mean, Filipina. Like, if it's a girl. I mean, you could do anything with just
sure. Philippa. That's literally what George did. I think he only has one Philip.
He has a Georgina, I'm pretty sure, or Georgia.
Yes, the one. I think he only has one girl, and it's Georgina. And then the rest are all George Foreman. But, yeah. So, shout out Philip Rivers. Shout out the ESPN graphic. Oh, yeah. Get the names. Run them down.
Philip and Tiffany Rivers' children. Hallie.
Oh, Penelope. That could be another one.
That could be a good one.
That's close enough.
Caroline, Grace, Gunner, Sarah, Peter, Rebecca, Claire, Anna, and then their baby boy on the way.
Who will be named Garth?
One of the kids was born when he was still at NC State.
Yeah, go Wolfpack. Yeah. Should have named it Mr. Wolf.
Wait, should we take a name? What would you name Philip Rivers' 10th child, given that you've heard the first nine?
Nash and Paul.
I think he's got to have a Philip Jr. He's got 10 kids and not one Philip Jr.
The first boy has to be Philip Jr.
Nash is a good one. Too late. Nash is a really
We'll change
good
Gunner's
one.
Name to Philip Jr. and name the 10th kid Gunner. You can do that.
What about Eliah? I kind of like Eliah.
Eliah?
Eliah Rivers. Or what if he names it like Mississippi? Like Mississippi Rivers.
Mississippi
like that
Rivers?
Would be awesome.
Colorado like Rivers.
Nile.
M-U-D-D-Y.
Muddy Rivers.
Red.
That would be awesome. Red Rivers.
Red Rivers.
Oh, I like gosh. Red. So I'm going to go with red. Here.
Yeah. Philip Rivers, watch this show and get at us and name your kid that. But yeah, 10th kid for Philip Rivers. Ratio.
Ratio of the week. This one comes from a comment on the SEC Network. Mizzou had their SEC Network takeover on July 10th. Let me see what this guy's a fan of. He doesn't have it in his bio or anywhere else. His name is David on Twitter. He said, I think I hate Eli more than Dabo. I don't think anyone likes Eli. He had 97 replies, 7 likes, and 2 quote tweets. A lot of Mizzou fans getting after him and telling him that they like Eli. I think it just depends.
97 people saying, I like Eli.
I like Eli.
I haven't seen it one comment that's not, I like Eli. Oh,
one
here's
guy's
one.
Ad is just Case IH Red
Zone. That's a great ad.
You have to read it like Case IH.
Yeah, do it like the announcement.
Red Zone.
Red Zone.
What other things did they have sponsored?
The first
did they have
down,
like, 20 yard line.
Oh God, it was something bank. First down.
Central Bank, yeah. Right?
Yes, mm-hmm. Central Bank.
Central
first
Bank.
Down.
I'm going to change my ad to Central Bank first down.
D-O-U. We didn't get a case I addressed much last year.
Yeah. Oh, I think this guy's a South Carolina fan after reading some of these replies. Someone said fire drink, but he still owns you. One person actually replied, I don't like Eli. I'm not going to read you what his name is on Twitter, but he is a Southern Cal and Clemson fan. Interesting.
What?
Southern Cal and Clemson fan.
Yeah. I thought maybe it was USC as in for like South Carolina, but he wrote out Southern Cal.
Southern Cal.
Yeah.
SoCal. Nice. Yeah. Good ratio. The replies scrolling through and just seeing, I like Eli. I like Eli. I like Eli was funny.
That was submitted by Justin Bear, friend of the show, Denver, Colorado. Not trying to dox, just saying he lives in Denver. There you go.
Kenny has gotten in trouble with doxing people on the show.
I pretty much doxed phone Peyton numbers. Earlier. I said where he used to live, but
we've had phone numbers.
Yeah. You doxed yourself too. You lived with me. We were roommates.
Yeah,
we did. Yeah,
everyone here has been a roommate to Kenny.
And with that, we'll go to the final segment. Talk some Tennessee football. All right, we're gonna finish the show. Going back to a little SEC talk, staying on the football side of things, because we had, a big-ish story as it relates to Mizzou. It is one of their SEC opponents year on year. So I thought it was a good headline. I guess not anymore after this. Yeah. But one of Mizzou's SEC rivals opponents, so to speak, got in a little bit of trouble recently. Tennessee football hit with a bunch of sanctions. Over 200 violations the NCAA found in terms of recruiting while head coach Jeremy Pruitt was there. This was over the 2019 and 2020 seasons. So over the past couple days, what's come out is they've had to vacate their 11 wins across those two seasons. They've been given 5 years probation. They've had to pay an $8 million fine. Like I said, over 200 recruiting violations, including over 18 level one violations. $60,000 of impermissible benefits made to players by Coach Pruitt and his wife. We have more details we can talk about, but I guess, guys, your first impression with just all of this, and then the headline, I should say the main thing summing all that up, Tennessee not given a postseason ban for any of this, despite the amount and the scale of some of these and the amount of money involved. No postseason ban for Tennessee. So they'll still be able to go to bowls, still be able to, of course, compete for the college football playoff, which I think a lot of people are expecting them to do this year under Josh Heupel now. Thoughts, first impressions on this situation with Tennessee.
I have two thoughts. The first one is really quick. It's funny that Coach Pruitt and I both like McDonald's bags. I like it for the food. He likes putting money for recruits in them. But my other thought is, if you're a program and you know there's violations in your program with recruiting or whatnot, don't cooperate with the NCAA. Nothing will happen to you, okay? Mizzou tried to get out in front of it when they had improper tutoring, and they're like, hey, we had a rogue tutor. It's just two players. And they're like, oh, Kelly Bryant, you don't get to play in a bowl game this year. That was 2019, of course, our freshman year. 2019, we didn't get to go to a bowl game because a rogue tutor went off. But you can sure as hell put $60,000 in McDonald's bags, drop them off at like a gas station or something. I haven't read through all the details, and have a recruit come pick them up, and you just erase a few wins. This also does mean that Eliah Drinkwitz officially has an above 500 season at Mizzou. So take that, haters.
Yeah, he went 5-4 in his first season in 2020 now. That game never happened, I guess, against Tennessee. And one of my favorite parts about that game against Tennessee is week two in Knoxville. I remember there being some like reports that players on the Mizzou side were saying that Tennessee defensive players were like yelling hard counts like at the offensive linemen to get them to jump and just like getting in their heads and stuff like that. And I mean, I don't know if that's against the rules. I don't think there's a rule against it, but I thought that was funny. That was one of the things they pointed out. All time now, Mizzou has 5 wins. Tennessee has 4. So Mizzou is now the leader in that category. Tennessee did have 4 consecutive wins against Mizzou. course, two of those were in Columbia, two of those were in Knoxville. So now the win streak is only two games for Tennessee and not four. Also, actually,
full
one more
disclosure,
thing.
I was going to say, I don't think it actually works like that. I don't think they just
the wins. Well, the wins, yeah, the wins don't get the wins don't get flipped, but Tennessee does. Like, yeah, they lose those wins in the record. Yeah,
yeah. Which so I'm saying, I mean, does Mizzou gain? Like, I'm not going to say they're going to gain two wins, but those two losses never happen.
Really,
right?
I don't know how that works. I'd have to look that up. I saw some people say they would technically be able to now say, "Hey, we're only 5-4 against Tennessee," mm-hmm. but others were like, "No, that's not how it works." So. Yeah.
Okay, well, other thing I just saw is a headline. It's this article was posted 5 minutes ago by a Indiana Hoosiers website, and it says, remembering the 2020 Indiana-Tennessee Gator Bowl, and it just read to me like, oh, the Gator Bowl died. Like, that year, that Gator Bowl is dead now because it never happened, and they're just talking about how Tennessee ended up beating Indiana in the Gator Bowl, and I guess they're saying, like, maybe if they weren't cheating, Indiana would have won.
Hey, I was going to say with your Mizzou hard counts, if Tennessee was doing impermissible benefits, wouldn't be all that shocking if they were just straight up cheating and
exactly.
And, you know, look at spying on Mizzou signals or whatever.
It was 6-3 at halftime in this game.
Oh. That was the year Indiana was really good. God, 2020 football was really bad.
Yeah, it was not good.
It was not good, but. Yeah, no, it's just kind of funny to see another SEC program get just over 200 violations. And Josh Heupel, you get to go to a bowl game next year. So
they made the Gator Bowl at 2-7.
Yeah, there were bad teams in bowl games that year. 2-8 South Carolina was supposed to be in the Gasparilla Bowl before they got COVID. It was
a bad season. Who won the national championship that year?
That was Bama. That was
that Bama?
Yeah, the CFP was great.
Oh,
I
remember. That was 2020 Bama because it was the comparison to LSU and Bama. That was like the because they were both really
Devontae
dominant.
Smith won the Heisman.
Mizzou played.
They did. They had the second closest loss, if I'm not mistaken. And the first was Notre Dame in the CFP semifinal.
Yeah. I just think, you know, Peyton mentioned with the 200, just that number. And I'm glad you brought up the Mizzou rogue tutor thing already, because I think this is just ridiculous that, like, you know, Mizzou, like, it just makes the Mizzou ruling. I know it's years ago now and it really doesn't matter. Like, none of that regime's even really there anymore, but it just makes it all that more ridiculous. And the hypocrisy of the NCAA just shines again. There was a quote. It was like, it said something like, because Tennessee showed exemplary cooperation after the violations were first reported, though a postseason ban was removed from any array of available penalties. In this case, the committee felt the punishment fits the crime. I just think, like, it's so ridiculous to say that after what they did to Mizzou when they also cooperated in a situation not even like this. This is paying athletes to come to college and just straight up violation. Mizzou had a tutor that was just like taking tests for kids. I don't understand this from a hypocritical standpoint, but go, do you have something?
The Tennessee football teams. Kenny, I'm really sorry. But Diana Russini of ESPN just tweeted, 3-time All-Pro wide receiver DeAndre Hopkins is expected to sign with the Tennessee Titans.
Oh, breaking
disgusting.
News.
Disgusting. Oh, my God.
The Oilers.
That's terrible.
He's making a homecoming, Kenny, but it'll be on the other sideline. I'm sorry. I know this is probably not what you were hoping for.
I have my jersey of the week.
Why on earth he's choosing to sign with Tennessee? I have no idea, but he will be a Tennessee Titan. Big week for Tennessee football.
Is their quarterback Josh Dobbs still? Or do they have Tannehill back?
No, it's not. It's Tannehill.
It is Tannehill.
Dobbs was so bad, they just let him walk after.
Yeah, that's right. Sorry, Kenny.
It's fine. I mean,
quick thoughts.
I wanted him to come home to Houston. He posted a video of him driving past NRG on Kirby Drive, like right when he hit free agency. And he was like just joking, like, oh, am I going to go back? And now he's going to the Titans. It's just gross. It's like looking at pictures of Andre Johnson in other uniforms. It's a little bit different, of course, because he played a couple of seasons in Arizona, but it's like seeing one of your star, you know, franchise wide receivers play for division rivals. Gross.
Didn't Andre Johnson also go to the Titans?
He played for the Titans and the Colts.
Such a two division rivals.
That is so. I'd be ugh.
For some reason,
it sucks to be a Texans fan.
This never happened, but I can like vividly like see him just like wearing a Seahawks uniform, and I don't know why, but he never was a Seahawk. Maybe it was like a rumor at one point, but
this is like when, speaking of Seahawks, though, it's like when Sherman went to the Niners. That was annoying.
Mm-hmm.
Well, sorry.
And then he broke into someone's house, but this is a little bit different. This guy's not breaking into a house.
Come through.
Yes.
I mean, he is making a semi-homecoming. He'll now be able to don the Oiler blue.
Can I leave? Is it possible to leave? I mean, I think they're wearing those uniforms this year, and they're probably going to wear them against the Texans. So.
That is really, really bad that Tennessee gets to wear Oilers.
Yeah, wait. Why do they let that happen? That's wild.
They've done it before when they lost that famous 59-0 game to New England. They wore the Oilers throwbacks for that.
Oiler blue.
I know they are the franchise. It's just like they have no ties to, like, that uniform is no tie to Nashville. It's just
there's a lot of oil rigs in the middle of Tennessee.
Yeah.
If you guys didn't know,
underneath that river, there's a bunch of oil.
And then a bunch of people are gonna say, like, they're gonna say it to me, there's another bunch of oil rigs in Houston. Yeah, there is. You know, I could see it. If I drive to Galveston, I see all the smoke. So I see the oil.
All the haze.
Yeah.
Earl Campbell,
I breathe it in every day.
Well, Warren day Moon was the, a Titan.
Warren Moon was a Titan, he was.
Warren Moon was a Titan. Yeah, wow. Good breaking news. But yeah, Tennessee college football. A lot of penalties, doesn't really matter because they could still go to the college football playoff. The other thing I just wanted to mention was that the $8 million fine, do you know where that figure was dug up from?
I probably the NCAA just throwing darts, but what
they said that the $8 million was how much money Tennessee would lose if they got a bowl ban.
That's ridiculous.
And didn't go to the playoff, which I think is absurd. And also, like, just a very nice blatant blanket over the, like, oh no, you also know NCAA that you'd lose a ton of money from one of your best current football teams not being able to participate in the bowl, but, you know, thanks. And it's, yeah, a major university is going to struggle to pay off an $8 million fine.
I've never been one to be like, oh, the world is against Mizzou or the NCAA hates Mizzou, but things like this definitely make it a lot easier to see that side of things.
It's not even for me an against Mizzou thing. It's just like the NCAA being just a joke of an organization at times. That's all. I'll happily stand by that take.
I can say that for sure.
Jack, do you remember when we were in Indianapolis and we were banging on the doors of the NCAA headquarters? And then
this is a good story to bring up. Yeah, go ahead.
The intercom went, "Hey, stop doing that." We were just like, "What?" Like, we like looked up. Yeah. We were so confused because we were just banging on the doors trying to get in.
Yeah, this was in 2019. We wanted to go to the, I think it was just like a museum, like a college sports museum.
Yeah, we thought it was the museum.
Yeah, we went in the back way. And we had a friend of the show who very bravely, I remember we were making jokes like, they're going to pull out a laser and just on site, trap door will open, he'll fall in. He'll have to live down there with Jeremy Pruitt for 2 years before he's allowed back.
Mm-hmm. They did come down. I'll give the NCAA this. Like, Jeremy Pruitt might never be able to be a head coach again. They did levy some pretty big punishments on him.
He has to sit for a year if he's hired back as a head coach in for an NCAA team. So,
yep.
Get ready to learn high school football, buddy.
Last thing I want to note before we get out of here. There was a pretty long tweet from Jim Nagy, who's the president of the Reese's Senior Bowl. And he like gave a lot of props to Tyron Hopper, Darius Robinson, and just Mizzou's defense in general. Darius Robinson replied to him, "Thanks, Jim Nagy, for the evaluation. I'll see you in Mobile after the season." That's a pretty hard tweet right there. Of course, Darius Robinson did receive an invite to one of the bowls at the end of last season. I think it was the Senior Bowl. He was not invited to the recent Senior Bowl. It was one of the lower bowls. He forgoed it, and he returned to college and looking for an NFL opportunity after this season.
There we go.
He kind should be very much getting one. I would think he'll be having his stock rise quite a bit this season.
Agree to agree. So good happy note to end the show on. Go Darius Robinson. He's living large in Mizzou. And yeah, I think I agree. I think his stock will jump up ahead of next year. All right. That'll do it for the Unwritten Rule for this week. We'll be back. Another fresh show for you guys on Friday. Maybe another school will get a random show cause ban. I can get more mad at the NCAA. Or maybe, I don't know, DeAndre Hopkins will have some funny tweets about Welcome to Nashville. But yeah, that'll do it for us. Everyone, have a fun and safe week. We will see you on Friday.